Hey, so this is just a demo looking through some of the circuits that I'm making available in a Logisim file on Canvas. Like I said in the previous video, I really hope that you'll download Logisim and the file and play around with this yourself. But just to get you started, I just wanted to walk you through and very informally show you a few things. So this is an optional video, but again, I hope that you'll take a look at these things. So what I've done is I've loaded up the file that I'm providing you into Logisim. And so you can see a bunch of the circuits over on the left here, and then so this is the first circuit here, the bit equality circuit over here on the right. So you can see there's an AND, it's another AND, a couple of NOTs, and an OR, and then these are the two inputs, A and B, and this is the output. So you want to make sure that you have simulation enabled, so that's in the simulate menu. And once that happens, you should be able to use the hand tool here to go and tweak these values. And so this is the bit equality circuit. So this should be true if and only if both of the inputs are true. And so you can see that that makes it not true. That also makes it not true. But if they're both on, then they are equal. So that's the single bit equality. Now, once we've built this circuit, we can, if you look at Edit Circuit Appearance, you can see that there's now a representation of this circuit, and it's sort of a black box now, and we don't really need to care about what's inside of it. So if I go to the next one here, so now each one of these squares here is in fact that same bit equality circuit that we just saw. So I've got four copies of that bit equality circuit here, 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 and here. So what I've done is I've now made a four-bit equality circuit here. So I've taken one input here, and I've split it into each of its, so this is a four-bit number. And what's kind of interesting is that if you click on the wire, you can see its representation in both binary and decimal. So this is four, this would be five, and so forth. So this is one input, this is another input. And so what you're going to get as output is whether or not these two numbers are equal. And the way we've done that is we've taken the input, we've split it into its individual bits, and then we've combined the corresponding bits. So this is bit 0 of A and bit 0 of B, and we put those into the first bit equality circuit. And so we do that for corresponding bits in all the corresponding bits. And then we have one giant AND gate here, which takes all of those inputs, you know, individually are the bits the same. And so the entire number is the same if and only all of the bits are the same. And so that's the output here. So in order for this to turn on, we have to make the B identical to the A. So anything else is going to give us a zero at the end. So I guess the point here is that, you know, we didn't have to start from scratch in building the circuit, right? We can use these circuits. We can use the bit equality circuit to help build the four-bit equality circuit, just like we talked about in the other videos. Okay, so here's the bit level multiplexer. So here's the selector bit. So this is going to select either A or B, so it would probably be useful to have different values. So now A is set. And you'll notice that as long as S is set, right, I can change A, and that will be changing the output. I can change B all I want, and the output is not going to change because it's currently selecting A. If I change it to select B, now the output is going to change whenever I change B, and it's not going to change when I change A. So that's why we say that this is a multiplexer, a selector, because we're using this bit to choose between the values A and B. And it doesn't matter really what those values are, we're just going to get whichever input we're selecting. Okay, so now we're going to extend this. So this is one we didn't see in the slide. So this is a four-way bit multiplexer. So now we have two selector bits, and we have four inputs. So it's still one-bit inputs, but it's a four-way selector because there are four inputs coming in. And so if we were to set the two selector bits to zero, we're going to get back whatever A is. And we can change any of these others, and the output doesn't matter. If I set this to 1, so this is 0, 1, or 1, then we're going to get whatever value B is. And if I set this to 2, we're going to get whatever value C is. And if we set this to 3, we're going to get whatever value D is. And you can see there's a pattern to how I've connected these. So this is true when both this selector bit and this one are off, right? So that's 0 and 0. This one is true when this bit is on and this one is off. So that's 0, 1, right? So you can look through these connections and work out what all these mean. And of course, we could do this for any number of inputs, right? The circuit will get more and more complicated the more we build. But, you know, we could build an n-way bit multiplexer where n is some power of 2, right? Okay, so what we want, though, is we want to be able to switch between multiple numbers rather than just multiple bits. So that's what I've built here. And at this point, I'm going to have to zoom out a little bit to see this whole circuit. But again, nothing new going on here. So these are those four-way bit multiplexers that we just saw. So there are four bits coming in, and we use the two selector bits to pick one of them. So basically what I've done here is I have taken our four-way one-bit multiplexer, and I've built a four-bit four-way multiplexer using them. So I've taken four inputs, and now each of these inputs are four bits wide. I've split them and reconnected them up to these one-bit multiplexers, such that each one of these multiplexers is choosing one bit of the final output. And I just use the same selectors for all of them. So these are the exact same selectors. They're just getting duplicated and handed to each of these multiplexers. So basically, I'm just splitting up the inputs and using a one-bit multiplexer to choose each of those. And so basically, what's going to happen is that, you know, if we are... So this is currently set to 1, 2, 3, 4. So if we set this to 0, we're going to get 1, which is A. If we set this to 1, we're going to get B, which is 2. And if we set it to 3, or to 2, sorry, we're going to get C, which is 3. And if we set this to 3, we're going to get D, which is 4. So now we have a two-way 4-bit multiplexer. Actually, sorry, four-way multi-bit. It's a 4-bit, it's a 2-bit selector, which means that it's a 4-way multiplexer. Another circuit that we didn't really talk about much during the lecture are decoders. So these will be useful next time once we start talking about register files. So the decoder takes a selector number. In this case, it's a 2-bit decoder. So it's sort of a four-way decoder, and it splits it into on or off for each of the individual possible values. So here, if this value is, you know, 0, 0, then only the 0 output is going to be set. If we set this to 1, only the 1 output is going to be set. This is the 2 output, and then this is the 3 output. So basically, we're now, this is kind of a decoder is kind of the opposite of a multiplexer. Multiplexer takes a bunch of values and kind of narrows them down based on a selector. A decoder takes a selector and basically splits it into a bunch of on-off signals. All right, so here's the half adder that we saw. So as long as only one of these is true, we'll get a 1 in the sum and a 0 in the carry. And then once they're both true, then we get a 1 in the carry and a 0 in the sum. So then we combine this with a couple other gates. And we didn't talk about the details here, but you're welcome to sit down and look through this. And basically what happens with this is that now we have this additional carry in, so that you know, the total sum that we could end up with is 3. And so now we can actually end up with the value 3 at the end if we had a carry in. As you will hopefully see in the lab today, there is also a way of extending this to 4 bits, and I'm not actually going to bring this up right now because it's the lab kind of takes you through it, and so I'll let you go to that. Here is a subtractor, which we didn't really talk about. You have to borrow instead of carrying for the subtractor. But what I want to do is go ahead and skip ahead to a whole full bit adder subtractor. So this is actually more complicated than what you're going to be doing in the lab. So here we have two numbers coming in and a bunch of connections, similar but not the same as what you're doing in the lab. And so what is happening here is that we're bringing in a single input that's determining whether we're doing addition or subtraction. So if it's 0, we're doing addition, and if it's 1, we're doing subtraction. And so here we have 5, add 1, and the answer is 6. 5, subtract 1, and the answer is 4. And again, nothing is new here. These are the full adders that we just saw, and then a couple of other gates. Here is a bit multiplexer, and that's just to handle the flags, and then there's another, some more multiplexers over here. So again, the details aren't super important, but I hope that you get to the point where you're comfortable understanding what's going on with these, and that you're able to sort of fill in the gaps if I ask you to complete a circuit that looks something like this, like you're doing in the lab. Okay, so finally, I want to show you what this looks like when you start putting everything together. So this square in here is that entire 4-bit adder subtractor that we had before. So all of this, you know, with all of these other boxes combined or expanded, right? All of that is now in this little box in this circuit, right? So that's really what we mean with this abstraction, right? We don't need to worry about all the details inside of that box anymore. Okay, so that's our adder subtractor. Here are two numbers coming in. These are now 4-bit lines, and they're drawn a little bit thicker, right? Because these represent 4 bits. So these are 4 bits coming into our adder subtractor. And now we have this thing called op. And what I'm going to assert is that this is choosing between addition, subtraction, and XOR. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to take this value and copy it, and I'm going to split off the first bit. So this is what's going to determine whether we're doing an addition or subtraction. Note that we're just discarding the second bit, so the high order bit here. It turns out that we're going to do the addition and subtraction regardless of which operation we want at the end. And in fact, that's generally true of computational circuits. They're generally going to do all the computation, and then you'll use something like a multiplexer here at the end to pick which answer we actually want. These gates are always constantly running in the background anyway, and so there's we're basically just going to do all the possible calculations that we might need, and then we'll pick the one that we actually need at the very end. So that's why we have this and this XOR down here, because this takes care of the addition and subtraction, and then this takes care of the and, bitwise and this takes care of the bitwise XOR. And if you look at this, like if we go into changing it, we'll see that this is actually a 4-bit and. So the data size in here is 4 bits. So it's got 2 inputs, but each of those inputs is itself 4 bits. So this is a little bit different than the gates that we've seen before, even though it looks identical to them. So it's actually taking each of these inputs and doing a bitwise and what we're getting back at the end is another 4-bit value. So for instance, let's plug in some values here. So you'll notice some things lit up coming in and out of the addition and subtraction, right? And in fact, I think that these lit up, right, because we're going to get some overflow here, especially if we're doing addition. Maybe not if we're doing subtraction, right? So this is still okay. But in any case, we are not looking at that right now. We're looking at the and. So we can look here and we can see what the result of the and is. And it is, 8 or -8 if we're interpreting this as 2's complement, because this is the only one that's still there. Down here we have 0011, right? And that makes sense because we're only going to get a 1 coming out of the XOR where the values are different. Okay, so all of these outputs, and you'll notice that we're taking the output of the addition subtraction and we're just duplicating it. And that's because, remember, inside of this circuit, which actually we can look at if we double click on it. So inside of this circuit, we're using this bit here to determine whether we're doing an addition or a subtraction. So I guess it's sort of not fair to say that we're doing both the addition and subtraction. We're doing either the addition or subtraction, and we're doing the and we're doing the XOR, and then we're just kind of picking between those three here at the end using this multiplexer. So if this is a 0 or a 1, we're doing the subtraction and we'll get whatever the value is coming out of the adder subtractor. If this is set to 2, then we get the and result, and if it's set to 3, we get the XOR result. And so hopefully you can see, I don't know if you can read the label over here or not, but this is actually a 4-bit version of the Y86 CPU. Or I suppose it should be labeled the ALU. It's just the arithmetic and logic part of the CPU. But this is sort of the entire thing for 4 bits. We have the adder subtractor, we implement the AND and the XOR operation. And so by specifying what operation we want to do, which you'll remember is encoded in the instruction, and assuming we have 2 values coming in, which will be coming in from a register file, which we'll look at next time, everything else in here we could drill down and look at, right? We've built all these up from the individual logic gates. And now we have an entire ALU that we could then plug into a larger system once we have some of the other components to build the full Y86 CPU. So I hope that this was helpful. And again, I hope that you'll go in and play with this. You can modify these circuits, you can try to extend it. It would be a really good exercise to try to take some of these and extend them from 4 bits to 8 bits or something like that, or to implement a new operation. Have fun and be creative. And I hope that you enjoyed this extra little demo, and I hope that it was helpful.